Professor Peter D'Souza is a political scientist at CSDS. He has had an abiding interest in the institutional realities underlying intellectual cultures. He is going to speak about something which is of urgent and immediate relevance to many of us in this university. His lecture is titled The Recolonization of Higher Education.
Thank you, Chandan. And let me say how delighted I am to be here among friends, some whom I've not met for many years, but delighted because I got another opportunity in another institution to speak about something that has been engaging me and troubling me, and which I suspect is perhaps a new set of questions that those of us in the humanities and the social sciences need to ask. My talk is titled Recolonization of the Indian Mind, deliberately provocative, because I'm beginning to be very curious about what is happening to our mind space. Not only curious, but also anxious, because I suspect that there are processes at work which, in a sense, make our mind space less free, less diverse than we actually think it is. And let me try in my lecture to set this out. Now, when I talk about mind space, I've used a word which is somewhat current in public discourse. I'm essentially talking of a public mind. And by public mind, what do I mean? I want to distinguish it from a private mind, from the work that each of us does as intellectuals, from the questions we ask as individuals, from the answers we arrive at, from the perspectives we develop. I'm not talking about the private mind, what I will broadly call the private mind, because that is diverse, that is plural, that is engaging with the multiple sources of knowledge and information that is coming in the digital world. So I'm not talking of that mind, I'm talking of the public mind. And by the public mind, I mean the public frame which in a sense drives policy making, and policy making which produces institutions, and institutions which produces outcomes. In other words, I'm talking about a mind that is at the base of our making public policy choices. It is a mind which is, in a sense, recommends certain agency, which gives us a certain perspective on how to order our world. So that's the public mind. Whether there's such a singular entity, whether it's homogeneous is a separate question, but I'm beginning to feel that our public discourse is driven by something called a public mind, which is being created and which is being developed and which is being driven by a set of forces that are the source of my curiosity and my anxiety. It is this public mind which determines what is relevant, and it is this which in a sense underlies the policy regimes that are developing in our country. So my talk is going to be trying to, in a sense, set out the elements of these forces that are creating this thing that I call the public mind, from which policies, institutions, processes, outcomes begin to flow as primary, as dominant. I mean, you will always find some counter examples, but you know, if someone makes a broad generalization like this, you must allow a certain simplification. Now, to understand this, I thought I should go back into an earlier debate, into a debate in history, and that is why, in the brief abstract to my talk, I begin with a statement from a philosopher during the colonial period, known to philosophers, one of the leading philosophers of that time, K.C. Bhattacharya, who wrote an essay. Again, if you're probably aware of this essay, called "The Swaraj in Ideas." And in that essay, he actually sees colonialism as producing an enslavement of the mind. So he makes a much stronger statement. He says colonialism produces an enslavement of the mind, and this experience of colonialism produces in the colonized habits of soulless thinking, and gives the illusion that you have developed a mind which you think is a real mind, but it's actually a shadow mind. In other words, it's not connecting with the world in which minds are supposed to connect with. And he develops his whole argument based on this idea of the enslavement of the mind, and argues about this. Now, he's a philosopher, so there's not any sociology in it. And he then looks at the way to get out of that is a Swaraj in ideas. So I want to take that. I'm going to give you similar arguments made by others who are fighting this colonial colonial encounter, and ask whether today, in universities across the country, in departments that are concerned with education, we really also need a new Swaraj in ideas. So that's what I'm inviting us to collectively do, because I haven't worked out the full argument. So but I'll give you the outlines of an argument, and the more people that participate in this debate, I think will help this exercise of whether we need a new Swaraj in ideas today. Now, if you look at the debate in other regions of the world. So for example, there's this very famous Martinican philosopher, Aimé Césaire, who wrote a tract called Decolonization of the Mind. And he makes a simple and powerful point that in the colonized world, the Western academy and the Western experience which the colonizer constructs in the colonized a sense of inferiority. And that sense of inferiority is presented as primitive. And therefore, the Western, the white man's burden becomes important, because you are inferior and you are primitive, and we have come to civilize you. And the way in which the colonizer begins to impact the mind of the colonized is to produce a feeling of inferiority. So I'd like you to keep that one argument in mind, inferior and primitive. You get in Franz Fanon a parallel argument which says that the ideas which emerge in the West are ideas which travel to the colony, but travel as if they are not carrying any cultural baggage, as if they are universal. So this whole argument of universality, that there are these ideas which emerge in a certain European frame, appear to be universal, and therefore they are adopted by the colonized as if they are universal ideas. This is again an argument which is now beginning to be challenged by Dipesh and a whole lot of others. The idea that they're not universal, they're actually parochial. But the idea that ideas, concepts travel, and this is something again we need to engage with. Do concepts travel as if they're not carrying cultural baggage? What happens to debates on democracy? What happens to debates on human rights? We adopt them, we treat them as our own, gender rights, gender justice, but are these deeply embedded in a certain cultural frame? You can go to, so you have a sense of inferiority, you have a sense of concepts traveling without cultural baggage. You have a Kenyan man of letters, Ngugi Thiong'o, who writes about decolonization, and he says that the decolonization is so complete that not only do you borrow the curricula of literature, so you have to teach Yeats and Longfellow and Shakespeare or whatever, but you begin to see, and he refers to this, Jane Austen characters in an African village. So the colonization of the mind is so powerful that you begin to actually see similar people with similar qualities in an African village. And then, of course, you have Rabindranath Tagore's whole experiment of creating an alternative university. There is another book by a Tunisian philosopher, Albert Memmi, Pillars of Salt. I'm just giving you sketches to show you how the colonization of the mind was such a powerful experience that the colonized, when they had to fight it, had to create multiple ways of challenging this colonization process. So Memmi, in a very powerful novel called Pillars of Salt, which is almost biographical, tells the story of a Tunisian person, a Jew, whose parents were partly Jew, part Berber, completely persuaded by the Western philosophical canon. He buys into it, distances himself from his colonial, from his cultural origins, because he thinks these great philosophical principles of truth, of standing up for the rights of the dissenter, the great Voltaire line. And in Tunisia, then the Nazis come. So all the philosophers who taught him this were unable to protect him. He went to their houses looking for protection, and they treated him as a stranger, which again raises the question that, you know, what happens to these philosophical arguments when confronted by power? So I've given you a series of sketches, and from my own region, there's considered the father of the Goan freedom struggle, Tristão Braganza Cunha, who talks of colonialism producing an erasure of culture, of the mind. So you actually develop a cultural amnesia. You don't know your culture. You don't know the roots of your culture. And you then develop this fake forms of culture, which he calls denationalization. Now, are these relevant? Are these, you know, is it relevant for me in 2014 to draw on a colonial literature or literature during a colonial period which is 100+ years old? Are these arguments still valid? Do they have a certain purchase for us today? I think they are important. And if I may just offer an example from something I read in yesterday's, in the most recent New York Review of Books, there is a review of a book by an American historian who spent his entire life, over half a century, researching slavery. And this review, I'm specifically giving an example of this because this is a review by the president of Harvard University, who herself is a very eminent historian. Drew Alpin Faust is the name. And an eminent historian who's got 6 books to her credit. And she's reviewing this text. It's a 3-volume study published over 50 years. So, you know, it's dedicated, deeply engaged with the literature. And the author of the text is looking at slavery and asking the question, how is it that slavery persisted and that there was a deep disjunction between ideas, between the world of ideas and social practice? How is it that the men and women of ideas did not see the world of social practice and slavery, that most inhumane of institutions, flourished and required a war? But when she's making this case, she's making a case of appreciation and makes the point that historically the world is moving to a period when this gulf between the world of ideas, human rights, individual freedoms, etc., and the world of practice is coming closer together. That gulf which was there during the period of slavery is not there today. I asked myself the question when I read that article, that is this true? Is the president of Harvard University, can she make this point because she's in a comfort zone of Harvard University? And why is it that Harvard University doesn't think that the kind of imperial foreign policy of the United States is similar in form to the institution of slavery? Because that's exactly what is happening to the rest of the world. It doesn't even enter the radar of concerns. It doesn't even enter the radar of relevance. That means the argument actually can be extended. She ends by saying, are we in an age of great moral questions? And to us in the other world, the great moral questions continue to trouble us. So I think the questions that were being asked by the philosophers of the colonial period still remain relevant today. And I think we need to engage with them. I mean, I've given you one example. I can give you another example about all this data snooping, which you know, I mean, I'm amazed at how little protest. Even the Guardian newspaper, which is the only one that stood up, actually allowed their computers to be destroyed. And it was not required by law. It was just a kind of request made by the British state to give access to that information. So what is there about the Western academy, which is my question, that creates this gulf between practice and thought? And saying it's just power is too facile an argument. I think we have to engage with the mechanics of the production of knowledge, with the mechanics of how that knowledge transmits, how it travels, what kind of mindsets does it produce, what kinds of comprador intellectuals it creates. Because in many senses, maybe we are participating in that process of creating the comprador. That, you know, in institutions like this, in institutions like the ones that I have had the privilege of directing, we may be actually participating in this whole process of colonization of the mind. So I ask the question today that is there, are we witnessing, if during the colonial period the intellectual world worked in the interests of the colonial project, and I've given you many arguments, you can, you know, these illustrations can be multiplied, are we as intellectuals today in a sense working in the interests of another project? And I call that the project of global capital. I think we are. And if I look at our institutional production and reproduction of ideas, I see it being driven by the interests of global capital. And that's really the substance of my argument. I think global capital today, and if you look at particularly the Western university and academy, is fundamentally challenging knowledge production that had dominated knowledge production for 200 odd years since the start of the Humboldtian universities. If you look at the Bologna process of universities, if you look at the direction, particularly the direction which the American university is going, you see a process of corporatization of the university system. The university is no longer an institution that was committed to just the production of knowledge. I mean, you know, the old universities of the first decade after the war, when, as Chomsky himself says, and this idea of corporatization comes from Chomsky, when he says it was, you know, going to university cost me a few hundred dollars. Now, almost every person in university leaves university with debt, huge debt. The corporatization of the university, corporatization in terms of fees, I mean, now you're paying something like $660,000 a year. Corporatization in terms of making the manager more important. So universities are now becoming like multinational corporations. I mean, these trends can be mapped. Corporatization in terms of nearly 70% of faculty in the United States are adjunct, and which means they get almost a minimum wage of something like $25,000. So the universities are in deep crisis, high salaries, low high fees, low salaries for adjunct elite faculty. Increasingly, the humanities and social sciences are losing space. These great liberal arts universities, again, I uses my authority, Martha Nussbaum, who talks in terms of the fact that education for sympathy and education for sensibilities is giving way to education in the applied sciences. What is most disturbing is the argument has shifted that education and fundamental to this whole process was that education was supposed to be a public good. And increasingly, it's now being seen as a private good. It is not something which benefits the whole of society. Therefore, society has to invest in the production of young people with capabilities. But it's a private good. You have to pay for it because you are going to be the beneficiary. And this argument is being won. So increasingly, you're getting the whole process of privatization of universities, universities becoming companies, universities setting up offshore campuses in places as, you know, like Qatar and Dubai and Singapore. I mean, today's newspaper has something which alarms the British government because the number of foreign students has declined from India and China in England. Universities as a source of revenue, universities as a source of generating profit, universities recognizing institutions all over the world which can give overseas validated courses. So you're beginning to see a whole process of converting education into a private good and converting it into a kind of commodity produced by large organizations. So if this is the direction in which knowledge production is moving in the interests of global capital, so if earlier it was serving the interests of the colonial state, I want to argue that knowledge production today is serving the interests of global capital, and I'll show five or six agencies that are actually driving this process. The first, of course, is the university. And here again, I think we need to again go back to Rabindranath Tagore's lament, when he felt that the structure of the university in our country, and that is why Vishwa Bharati was such an interesting example, was actually unsuited to us. He says, when you think of a university, immediately what comes to mind is Oxford and Cambridge. And therefore, you take the entire structure of Oxford and Cambridge and try and replicate it in India. And that's wrong, because Oxford and Cambridge and the universities of Europe emerged organically as the culture of Europe developed. The institution of the university, which is the full-grown university, evolved over a long period of time. So not only did its structure develop over time in response to changes, but the nuances, the conventions, the practices developed through a certain culture of the place in which it was developed. So when you take that institution, the full-grown institution, and transplant it to another culture, you are taking an institution, as Tagore says, which will result in the crippling of minds. So that's one question. What is he saying? Is he saying that the management structure is alien to us, and he tried to create a different structure in Vishwa Bharati? Is he saying that the organization of knowledge into disciplines is alien to us? And that's an argument that has been made in Indian philosophical circles, that we, you know, philosophy, sociology, history, political science, that things are much more integrated, they should be treated as integrated. Is he saying that the content of the curricula is alien to us? Is he saying that the pedagogy that we adopt, the kind of classroom method, is alien to us, and that it should be much more guru, shishya, parampara? Or is he saying that the medium of instruction, he's also saying that, is alien to us, that we now need to do things in the vernacular. I mean, in the Punjab of 1888, there was a movement to set up a Punjab university which was delinked from Calcutta University, because Calcutta University was increasingly moving in the anglicized way. So way back in 1888, the people of Punjab collected vast sums of money to set up a separate university which would, they wanted, provide instruction in the vernacular, which did not happen, because the Senate of Punjab University, made up of Englishmen, insisted that it should be in English. So these are five or six issues that those of us who are trying to understand, I mean, I don't want to appear that I'm giving you a well thought out ideological position, that on each of these I think we are doing wrong. I mean, I'm saying we need to debate management structure, we need to debate organization of knowledge into disciplines, we need to debate content of curricula, we need to debate the pedagogic strategies that we adopt, and we need to debate the medium of instruction. Now, the Indian university seems to be mimicking the Western university, and increasingly we see ourselves as moving in the direction of what is happening. And even in the Western universities, we are actually using the American model. We are not going into the European model. I mean, we are increasingly, the privatization of university education is following the American model. Fees are going up, internal organization is much more corporate. I don't know what is the structure of student intake, so, you know, is there a kind of inclusion-exclusion axis around which we can map this? But the universities in India in the period immediately after independence were actually expanding because of a process of the democratization of knowledge. Knowledge became a contested political domain, and the democratization of knowledge. So regions wanted their own universities. Many universities were set up across the country because a university was an important sign of the aspiration for that region. So Shivaji University was set up because the Kolhapur area wanted to have their own university. And you can see that in a lot of the regional universities. Goa University was set up because how can you have a state without a university? So that is that democratization of knowledge phase coming to an end, and are we moving into a period of the corporatization of knowledge? So that's one domain in which I think a series of questions need to be asked by those of us who want to see whether we are in a process of a recolonization of the Indian mind, by looking at what is happening to the production of knowledge within the university system. Is that production of knowledge being driven by the private interests that support the university system? Even more pernicious are the consultancies that have come up that are now becoming the new purveyors of knowledge production. I don't think those of us who live in universities actually have noticed this fact. We live in a world which we assume is the world of the 1970s and the 1980s. So when you sit in the university, you think you're going to a university which is a 1970s university, and you know you're producing knowledge, and that knowledge has got many takers. But believe me, if you look at your policy domain today, the more significant people giving advice to government, to policy making, are coming from the consultancies and not from universities. So you're producing knowledge for yourselves. No, it's not going into changing the world. And it's really disturbing, because if you actually begin to see the five or six big consultancy organizations, they are offering advice to government on everything, on culture, on water, on natural resources, on education. I mean, you just do a Google on the web and you will find two reports on Indian higher education, one produced by PwC, PricewaterhouseCoopers, and one I think is KPMG, on higher education as a business opportunity in which invest, you know, and it actually maps the billions of dollars that are available for higher education. So, but if you think, I mean, so what I want to you know alert us to when I'm talking about the recall, when consultancies produce knowledge, which then feeds into policy, which then produces the institutions, which then produces the outcomes, they are doing something which is very, very alarming. Because when we produce knowledge, when we sitting in universities produce knowledge, somewhere at the back of our mind, somewhere in that act of production is a commitment to the truth. So we then adopt certain protocols of testing, of disproof, of challenge, of contestation. And if somebody has, you know, more persuasive arguments, or somebody has more persuasive arguments with much more complex evidence, then that argument somehow begins to... There is a process of epistemic relativism, but we push it to the extreme. The relativism is the final frontier. But till you reach that frontier, there is contestation. And that contestation is based on marshalling of evidence and on marshalling of argument. So truth somewhere is there in the picture. But when consultancies do that, they don't do it because there's a commitment to the truth. They do it because of the client that is sponsoring the study. It seems like I'm making a simplistic point, but I'd really like us to see what happens when truth gets displaced by interest. And what does that do to the production of knowledge? When interest becomes the logic behind which the production of knowledge knowledge is being produced, what does it do to the act of production? What does it do to the act of production of knowledge? What happens to that knowledge? In philosophical debates, we have long arguments about, is that knowledge reflective? Is it, you know, is what is its correspondence to the world that it seeks to explain? How well does it represent the world, etc.? But when and that is in some sense debating with truth, with a small t. But when interest replaces that, what happens to this? I mean, do they, for example, in this production, is there a concern with the fact that that we on issues of gender rights or gender justice or Dalit rights? I mean, are things which do not in any way have any commercial relevance items which will enter into the argument? So consultancies. Now, how do these consultancies get this business? You know, I've talked about displacement of universities by consultancies. I'm maybe overstating my case. But how do they get the business? It's even more interesting. And this is all anecdotal evidence, because this is not an area that has been studied. So, you know, it'd be wonderful if students start picking these up. They get these contracts from government, because when they bid for that, they are the lowest tender, because they put zero manpower costs. So they don't charge for their human resources. So they are the lowest, so they get it. Now, universities can't afford to do that, because your cost has to be calculated into the cost of the bid. But how are they able to do that? Remember, these are big international consultancies. These are big international consultancies that pay the highest salaries. I'm sure all of you would love to be employed by them when you finish. You'd love to get a job with KPMG or... it's because corporates cross-subsidize. So the minimum cost that you... When you do a consultancy for a water firm, you will charge $250,000. But when you do it for government, you will charge zero. And what you're getting is access to very important and privileged information. So these are strategies of access. And they are now beginning to drive knowledge production. So you have the corporatization of the university. You have the increasing takeover of knowledge production by consultancies. Let's take the third instrument of recolonization of the mind. The investment banks. Now, here again, something very interesting is happening. And similar to the consultancies, but slightly different process. You know, those of us who did our social sciences and humanities in the 70s learnt our politics during our postgraduate studies. We did our first degree and we sort of got a sense of our politics, but we didn't develop a framework of politics in the first degree, because we were still not, we didn't even know what questions to ask. These were, when I say 70s, I mean, I'd invite you to go to the period immediately after the emergency. It was a period of turmoil. It was a period, you know, if my parents' generation was the freedom struggle, my generation was the emergency. We're trying to understand what's happening to this India. You know, initially we were told emergency was good because trains ran on time, but then later on we were told no, this, that, and you know, so questions of civil liberties came up, questions of tyrannical laws came up, questions of rights came up, questions of surveillance came up, and all of us believed in the center, but we developed our politics in the second degree. You know, some of my colleagues sitting here will remember that. We developed our politics after we had finished our first degree, because then we were just finding our feet. But by the second degree, we had started asking the right questions and started taking positions vis-a-vis the state and vis-a-vis the world. So not just the state, vis-a-vis the world. So, you know, we had to have a position on the Palestinian question, and we had to have a position, and this was active student politics in a small university in India. We had to have a position on, you know, are you for the Vietnam War or against the Vietnam War? I mean, I want you all to appreciate this. You know, all the songs that you'll listen to on your iPads and all the were songs that emerged in a certain period of knowledge protest. You know, student protest, which transformed the universities of the 60s in the West and came to India in the 70s. Peace protest, which transformed attitudes to war in the 60s and the 70s, which was part of our public discourse, which actually the whole argument on rights emerged, and so on. So we developed this politics in the second degree, by and large, because you were also of a certain age. Today, what is happening? Those who would normally enter this kind of political world of struggle and challenge and contestation, and that's what youth is about, that's what all of y'all are about, of challenging the order, immediately get picked up by consultancies. If you look at the consultancies, pick you up straight after your first degree. The best and the brightest are entering the world of the consultancy and investment bank straight after their BTECs or their BA economics or their... So you're not available to the world of protest. Where will the voice, where will the voice against this recolonization come from? Why is there not enough protest? Why is it that suddenly there's such a surge for support for Aam Aadmi Party, but it's a kind of emotional surge? Where is the philosophical frame? Where is the political frame within which that support among young people on social media and all emerging from. So the third instrument working in the interests of global capital is this instrument of co-option, which is coming from the investment banks. And it's quite alarming because you begin to see, again, anecdotal evidence, the size of these banks, we're talking of institutions of 140,000 employees. You're not talking of small change, you know. These are not small organizations. These are huge organizations that have a global footprint. And not only do they have a global footprint, they run the global economy. So if we are talking about knowledge, which is going to determine the shape of the world, and all of us producing knowledge, which will change the way in which we order our world, forget it. You've already lost the battle because you're not producing that knowledge. And you're not producing that knowledge because you're in the wrong institution. So today, we think it is Washington which runs the world. It is actually Wall Street which runs the world. I mean, make no mistake about it. And Wall Street runs the world by taking over your central banks. It's not just controlling knowledge production. It's also controlling the levers of power that drive this knowledge production. So who's the head of the Bank of England? From which investment bank or which consultancy? Check it out. Who is the head of the European Central Bank? Which consultancy? Who is the deputy governor of our own Reserve Bank? See where they come from. So you're beginning to see a kind of Milibandian thesis of people from certain interests in certain institutions. And this is alarming because this is also the time for protest. We live in a world where people who knew me from JNU will find it surprising that I'm sounding so radical at this stage in my life. I was a very middle of the road liberal. I didn't earn my politics in left politics. So I'm not speaking left. I'm just speaking straightforward consistency with questions of a humanist future. And we begin to see that. You know, so the 1% movements in the West, the Occupy Wall Street movements, are all challenges to the global. But where is the knowledge coming from? Who is protesting against these practices of the state? 5 more minutes? So that's the third. Let's take the fourth instrument of knowledge production, which is the media. I mean, we are too timid to ask critical questions of the media because we think by asking that, in some sense, you're going to invite censorship. But the media is a corporate media, and you just have to see. I mean, I wonder if you've had classroom debates on the Crimea question. And I'm sure all 90% of our positions are anti-Russian and pro-West, as you know. You know, armies cannot walk in and so on and so on. But have we even bothered to get into the history of the place? Because we've all developed our perception of the world from respectable BBC. And how can BBC be wrong? BBC is, but this is driving our understanding of the world. This is driving, so, you know, who is the good guys and who are the bad guys are being constructed and reconstructed and reconstructed through these large instruments of knowledge production, and the media is certainly one of the most powerful. Now, what is interesting is all these instruments come together, and somebody like Edward Said, mapping this in an earlier period, talked of an interlocking system. So if you begin to look at the links between the media houses, the investment banks, the consultancies, the big universities, I mean, I forgot to mention the big private universities in the US, they are all part of the same game, and they're not being interrogated. So now this view of the world, which they are producing and reproducing, is a view of the world we adopt. And that is why I talk about the recolonization of the Indian mind. So we actually have bought into the neoliberal frame, which is being produced and reproduced by these 6 or 7 institutions of knowledge production. So we actually think that the only way forward is the way that they have that they recommend and endorse. We don't even consider any other way. We don't even consider alternative. Now, for example, in Bolivia, there are alternative struggles taking place in the Latin world. In Bolivia, I'm told, in the new constitution, they have given rights to nature. Now, that's very interesting. How can nature, which is inanimate, have rights? I thought rights were only for sentient beings like us. Rights are, after all, claims or immunities or privileges. How can nature have rights? So obviously, there are alternative cosmologies out there. The Gandhian frame was an alternative cosmology. But do they even enter our classroom? Do they even enter our construction of alternative futures? Do we even, for example, Hind Swaraj, do we treat it as a text that must be seriously read? Or is it just the romantic text of a romantic old man who gave us freedom? I mean, take Gandhi's concept of trusteeship. What I'm saying is that today we are living in an intellectual frame which is a pale imitation of the frame that the West has produced. I'm sure within that there are plural positions. I mean, I'm aware of the plurality, and I know you'll ask me a question, but how can you say there is one West? There are multiple Wests. I know all that. But I just do not want to accept that there is no locus of power in this. And that's the point I want to make, right? Recognizing that there is a clear, so we produce and reproduce the frameworks of significance. That's the point. We produce and reproduce the frameworks of significance that constitute the way of life and the aspirations that the West has given us and given the whole world. Now, there are alternative cosmologies, and it is our challenge. If we have to fight, if we have to do a new Swaraj in ideas, it is our challenge to find these. For example, Gandhi's concept of trusteeship. Now, what is this concept? I mean, have we even seriously investigated it? It's a concept, and I want to suggest to you that it's a concept which has tremendous purchase. It's a concept which has a moral dimension to it. It's a concept which, if enough technical people get into the act, can give it a technical like profit or like reward. Reward is a similar concept. Today, under global capitalism, we say, "Oh, the chief executive." Let's take somebody is passing out of IIM, and you know, headline says, "Oh, the person has been offered $100,000 salary." And it becomes headline news. How did they get $100,000? How did they compute that this person who's just finished IIM is worth $100,000? I mean, is it a technical exercise? Did they put it through a model and arrive at a figure? Was it number crunching? Was it a normative exercise? Was it an intuitive exercise? But we buy it as if it's a hard objective fact. We assume that $100,000 which that person from IIM gets is indisputable because that's what he or she is worth. Trusteeship is like that, but trusteeship is not backed by the technical, the econometrics that global capitalism has produced. So when Gandhi says that the moral argument is that the wealth is in your trust and you should use only that which is a proportion of it, so what should that proportion be can be a technical exercise, and only that which you need. And the rest belongs to God or the whole people. A powerful moral argument, but no technical tools have been used to convert that into the idea of worth, that global capital. It's an identical concept, but worth has gone through, you know, all the econometrics of all the business schools, and we think it's an objective measure. But trusteeship, oh, it's an ideal romantic measure. The same. If you do an analytic of that exercise, you'll find it's a parallel concept, but one is treated as romantic and the other is treated as hard fact. So what do we need to do to build a Swaraj in ideas today? If there's a recolonization, and I've tried to set out that process, we need to look for an alternative discourse. We need to create a counter discourse. And to create that counter discourse, we need certainly to actually attempt a 5-part or a 6-part exercise. We need to look for alternative thinkers. Are there such people who will help us fight this global production and reproduction so that we see it as normal? We have, the way the world is now normal. You know, so, and today let me tell you, this normalization is not an option, certainly for your generation. My generation will be dead by the time the planet, but I mean, the latest IPCC report has come out, and the latest IPCC report has put very clearly that the planetary survival is at stake. The seas are, the global, not just global, the seas are slowing down, the global currents are slowing down. Freakish weather is affecting food production. India is going to face a crop loss of something like 43,000 crores. I mean, we are, the whole biosphere is under severe stress because business as usual is not available. But who cares? Because we have not produced the counter knowledge. Because we don't know where to look. Because we just don't know where to look. We are not looking. So we need to, first of all, look for alternative thinkers. Where are they going to come from? The Paulo Freires of yesterday. Where are these Paulo Freires? I mean, even when I look for names, I look for names of the 60s and the 70s. Where is the 2014? Stiglitz, we come up with Stiglitz. But Stiglitz was chief economist of the World Bank, right? Till he cut loose. I mean, sorry, this is a classroom situation, so I can be frank, but you know, I don't want to in any way demean anybody or criticize anybody. So, I mean, please treat that as a caveat. I'm just giving examples because I think the counter discourse has to be bold and has to be challenging. And for that, first of all, we need to look for alternative thinkers. We need to look at alternative constructions of law. We need to look at alternative constructions of the economy. We need to look at alternative constructions of lifestyle, of design, of fashion. We build skyscrapers using technologies which come from the West. And the whole construction methodologies, of course, Laurie Baker tried that, which are more suited to our ecology. I don't know how much of that enters into our curricula. So we need alternative thinkers. We need alternative concepts. We need concepts like trusteeship, and there can be many. So thinkers, concepts, or like from South Africa, Ubuntu. Or, I was reading about higher education, a tract published by the Council of Higher Education in South Africa, and it's called Kagisano. And Kagisano means producing these things together. So the idea of producing not for, not with, but producing things together. So, you know, we need to look at these alternative ways of organizing our world. Rights, Bolivia, the indigenous people of Latin America think that nature has rights. Our own tradition of indigenous medicine, when you use herbs and other things, I believe you have to ask nature for permission to borrow a herb. There's a whole ritual that goes with borrowing, you know. So we need alternative thinkers, we need alternative concepts, we need alternative texts. We need to find books that we will bring into the classroom. We need, for example, start with Tagore's The Eastern University. Read Tagore's, I mean, why has Vishwa Bharati succeeded or failed? I mean, what's your intuition? Is it a successful experiment or is it a failure? Anybody? I mean, I talked to some of the brightest people in the academy and they're all students of Vishwa Bharati and they think it was the greatest experience. But how many of you would go to Vishwa Bharati? It is? So, you know, here was an attempt to create an alternative university framework, to create an alternative curricula, to create an alternative way of, so, you know, all students had to do art, also. I mean, is it outdated? Do we need a new university form? And please don't think that my question about your new university form is outdated. He's a remnant of the hippie culture or something, you know, so dismiss him. I mean, take your modern IT companies. They are also looking at new forms. You know, so How come in IT they can have new production methods and new forms? You know, you can come when you want, you can do, you know, but you don't want it within the university. You don't want it within knowledge production. You want it within corporate production, but not knowledge production. So we need new thinkers, we need new concepts, we need new texts, you know, Hind Swaraj. We need new practices. How should we, you know, work towards, now Bangalore is a city full of lakes. What is the lake in the urban imagination? I mean, somebody was saying, don't buy property. I heard somebody was saying, don't buy property because they present it as near a lake, but the lake becomes the disposal point for all the sewage next to the. So what is our understanding? So, you know, we need new practices. I mean, I'll give you the example of the Pani Panchayat in Maharashtra, which is a very successful experiment. So there are such practices all over the world. But we have to look for them, and we need new institutions. So can we mount this counter discourse? It can only come collectively. It can only come if students from all over begin to search for this alternative, and create a sufficient momentum. It is happening. It may be happening in isolated pockets in India. But it's happening in other countries of the global south. It's seriously happening in Latin America. It's seriously happening in, so you have an experiment in people's budgeting in Porto Alegre. You have rights to nature in the Bolivian constitution. You have, you know, methods of transfer, targeted transfer, Bolsa Familia in Brazil. I don't know enough, but You know, there are such practices that we have to imagine and create. And if we have to, in a sense, resist this colonization of our minds that global capital is producing and reproducing, and believe me, it's driving us to the brink of planetary sustainability, then that exercise will have to come from those who are committed to making ideas. So thank you very much, and look forward to the discussion.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for the talk. You have alluded to issues, some of which I was intuitively aware of, like the media, the investment banks, some of which were new. Like the universities, etc. Like, and you have also suggested some of the ways. But when you suggested ways, it seemed to me that we are looking help from outside. Whereas, I think the solution should come from within. We don't want help from outside. What's your take on that? Because Vivekananda, if you read, he will say that if you are hoping that someone will help and some scholar will come and deliver the knowledge, the institutions, you are hoping against hope.
No, you see. Okay.
Sir. Sir, India is a land of contrasts, and we have been seeing for the ages that different time frame was taken for different kind of ideologies. And going by the neoliberal agenda, which is crossing the barrier of the nations. So what will be the, although it's very difficult, but I would like to know from you, what is the way to counter those things, living, we talk about indigenous technology as well as we need to think about those aspirations which you're talking about, Gandhian model and those things. So what exactly should be the path for, as a nation, India, to adopt the best of the technologies as well as economic development, and of course, not be driven away by the Western, you can say, anarchism, you can say that way. So So please highlight on that.
Yeah, thank you, sir, for the talk. I got two questions. One is that this kind of scenario which you describe on commercialization of the university and the and controlling systems of producing knowledge, it's absolutely the same for. So I wanted to know what linkage we can look at for schools and the university in that in bringing change. I mean, without talking about the elementary. Without talking at the elementary level, jumping higher education will seem a little gap, will create a little gap in the whole educational system. And the second is on the alternative kind of education which you're speaking on. I heard about the university, Swaraj University in Udaipur, which is trying to create the kind of same model which you're speaking of. But the kind of acceptance is still not there. The same happened with the Bhattacharya University. So what which we can see to bring those changes, bring those kind of acceptance for these kind of alternative ideas?
Thank you for those questions. I think on the first question on me sort of expecting change coming from outside, I think this inside outside is to me, my boundaries are slightly different from the boundaries of the nation state. I mean, I would see the inside as part of the global south, not just India, but other countries of the south. They would be on the inside for me, because I think in many ways they are facing similar challenges of transformation. We are all societies in deep transformation, multi-layered transformation. We are all societies having, globalization has connected us, so we can't exit globalization. And therefore, those drivers are pushing us towards certain structures of unsustainable consumption. So where do we then begin to find ideas of how to respond to this? By looking at other countries that are similar to us, that are like us. And therefore, when I gave you, I deliberately gave you an example from South Africa on law, an example from Bolivia on constitution, from Brazil on budgeting. What I'm saying is that we need to look at practices of communities like us who are also challenging this colonization of the mind, because they are also being colonized. And communities have a capacity to be innovative. All of us have a capacity to be innovative. I mean, we can all fight. Subaltern studies have shown that however dominant the powers are, the subalterns will always find ways to subvert it. You know, the weapons of the weak. So, what I'm saying is let us build these solidarities so that we can learn from each other. You know, Pani Panchayat can be for people in sub-Saharan Africa. We can take that example to them. I came back from Mauritius recently and I was fascinated that Mauritius is an island country. So they have a serious problem of power generation because they have to import everything. So what have they done? They've created solar panels on all the houses. So the house now becomes an independent unit of energy production. And if it has surplus, it can sell it to the grid. Now, what will this do to the power companies? Fantastic. So there are these very, that means a school, a house can be a unit of energy production. It's collecting solar energy. It's producing a surplus during the day, and that surplus is going into a grid, which then goes to industry or whatever. Right? So you can create mini grids, that mini grids can connect up to a national grid, that national grid, and all for free, which means you cut out the corporate, you cut out the big power companies that don't want an invest. So there are such innovative practices in other regions of the world that also have to do some very complex budgeting. So for example, in Swaziland, again, for those of you who are interested in schools, a lot of children don't have access to electricity because the grid does not reach their home. So what they have done is they've created an incentive system where all children are given solar lamps, right? But the problem is you have to charge a solar lamp. So the school has developed stations for charging of solar lamps. So it's an incentive for that kid to bring the solar lamp and come to school, charge it and go back. So at night they have, Now, these innovative practices are there. The cycle for schools, for girls in Bihar, right? I think we have to be innovative and imaginative in that way, because it is when others will be getting old, you know, standard corporate models of, oh, you know, you air-conditioned schools in Vasant Vihar or something, you know, which are there. I mean, so the inside, the ideas will not come from the outside. I agree, they will not come from the corporate world. They have to come from the inside. But who is the inside? I would say the global south. Okay, I mean, we can debate this. Don't this is but what I'm trying to say is that unless we build such solidarities, we will not get the benefit of ingenuity and innovation in other regions of the south that are also fighting against the neoliberal global order which has taken shape. How will we respond? What is the time frame? That's a tough question. I mean, I think connected to my answer now, we have to keep looking for counter examples. I mean, what is very clear is that we have to create a counter discourse. There is a hegemonic discourse, and that at the moment has produced in our ways of seeing a singular way, that this is the only way forward. We all have to become little Americas if we want to, but America is the most wasteful country on earth in terms of its resource use. And if you begin to, unfortunately, we don't debate that. We all think it's the land of liberty and freedom. I mean, look at their jails. You know, I mean, disproportionate of people coming from minority groups are sitting in jail. I don't know how many of you know, but many of the jails are privately run. So it's a business proposition. A jail is a business proposition. You outsource it. Your criminal system to private companies. So, you know, the state, but I don't have all the answers. I mean, it's been tough enough to mount such a large argument that I've tried to do today. And I'm sure there will be many gray areas and many counterfactuals that you may wish to point out. So what should our school look like? Again, I would invite you to go to, Tagore's experiments, because he exactly had that in mind. He wanted to link the school with the university. So Sriniketan and all were part of that exercise of linking up the school with Vishwabharati. Has it succeeded? Has it not succeeded? Why and what, since education is one of the streams over here, is something, it would be wonderful if this is a project that the students here take up. I mean, is it leadership? Is it that the curricula is outdated? Is it that the curricula is wonderful, but the social culture is driving students away from that? Is it that knowledge has grown so much that if you want to be a physicist, you can't spend time in clay modeling, you know, in the art school, which is what you're supposed to do? Is it the notion of the complete person wrong? Are we all just fragments? Do we have to live our lives? Sometimes when I drive around Bangalore, I wonder if we are looking at, I mean, very glamorous, wonderful city, but, you know, has global capital produced cogs in a large machine of production? So I don't know, but there is an experiment that we need to look at, and that can be looking at what happened in Shantiniketan between, the Sriniketan and Vishwabharati is something that can be looked at. And again, on the alternative question, I think, we all have to look. I've given you five sites where you can look at. I mean, five sites, and those are conceptual sites. Those are not inside, outside. You have to look for alternative thinkers, and there are such people. You can find them within the Buddhist tradition. There's a Vietnamese monk who's gained a certain, he's producing a certain cosmology. So look for alternative thinkers. You look at, you know, for legal philosophy, look at Albie Sachs in South Africa. I mean, the whole idea, take the Truth and Reconciliation Commission in South Africa. I mean, that's a complete departure from Western jurisprudence, because what does it argue? It argues that the perpetrator, you do not need to have evidence which is conclusive to get justice, which is the basis of Western jurisprudence. That, beyond reasonable doubt. Here you say that, no, we want catharsis. Justice is catharsis. So we know you'll never get the evidence of how the act was committed. So what do? You say, let us bring the perpetrator and the victim together, and let the we will give the perpetrator some degree of guarantee that you will not be prosecuted as long as you confess, because the victim wants to know whether his mother or his child, wife actually disappeared. You convert a disappeared person into a dead person, and that fact was so necessary for that person to move on in life. So you had the Truth and Reconciliation Commission created. So we need to look at alternative concepts, alternative institutions. So I've given you five sites: thinker, text, concept, practice, institution. And that we have to search for, and there are such practices.
Greetings, sir. I'm pretty confident my question might not have a conclusive response, but I want to know your response to this particular question with relation to what you've been talking about. The individual as a microcosm who's actually inducing a certain level of change. And if there will obviously be certain levels of systemic resistance that comes with whatever level of change that you're trying to cause. In relation with what one of the students had spoken about, even the Khoj project started by Tista State Vivad faces a certain level of resistance from the state in incorporating that kind of curriculum into like the mainstream education. So my question to you is basically, so is this always going to be an alternative? Or is there a chance for, considering there is a certain level of systemic resistance, is there a chance for this alternative to actually become a mainstream method of looking at things with respect to the resistance that we face?
I just wanted to play like devil's advocate here. So basically you're implying a certain power which is shaping the mainstream discourse, and then we're trying to come up with an alternative discourse. But I think the question to ask is, whose alternative is this? And where is this urge for an alternative discourse coming from? Is there a certain sense of power flowing there as well? Because we live in times when a certain section of population, even which includes a large section of subalterns, for all we know, they may be looking for the kind of Western education that we have been products of. And can we use these arguments to deny them that? Or can we, a farmer who wants to be growing sugarcane, cotton, and sell it, make money, sell it to external market and make money, can we ask him to continue growing bajra and millet, be self-sustained? Or what do we do? You know, I mean, where is this urge for an alternative coming from? Whose alternative is it? And how do we, you know, how do we bridge those gaps?
I'll take these two. These are both very, very important questions, and I thank you for them. How do we deal with systemic resistance? I think the only way I can answer your question is to go back to history. If we look at when counter ideas came up at any period of history, there was huge systemic resistance. But as the struggle continued, they, through some process of osmosis, generational change, whatever, they became mainstream. I mean, I went to university in the 80s in the UK. And at that time, the environmental movement was, they used to mock the environmental movement. I remember there was a phenomenon called acid rain. The coal thermal power stations in England would burn coal, and the acid rain would fall in the forests of Norway, and the Norwegians' forests would get damaged because the wind would take all the sulfur and the condensation would take place over there. And Margaret Thatcher was prime minister, and everybody said, no, we must do something about this because it's environmentally polluting, and she mocked it. She really mocked it. And she got the chairman of the Central Electricity Generating Board, I remember this, to actually do a pilot study of pumping carbon dioxide into some forest area and to see what damage it would cause. And there's no damage. So, you know, this is the kind of resistance. But today, I mean, nobody in the world will say that there's, you know, there may be climate change skeptics. But you go to the, you know, I mean, I was in Shimla for 5.5 years. And one, there is a beautiful forest tree called the rhododendron, which in April blossoms with red flowers, beautiful red flowers. And it blossoms in April. One January it blossomed. And because it was very warm in January, so the tree got confused and it came out. No, it's very serious. Yeah. So I remember going for a walk and asking the local, they said, "Ye kya ho raha hai?" Sir, global warming. All the global warming is now a Hindi word. It's not an English word any longer. So my answer to you is that I think it begins to seep into our public discourse. And I think the answer comes generationally. So if we mount a sufficient discourse and don't worry about whether we'll succeed or not, it will, you take this in the women's movement, our language has changed. You take it in the Dalits movement, our language has changed. You take it in terms of the environmental movement, our language has changed. So, you know, the perception has changed because this now, I mean, I was at a seminar 2 days ago in Delhi chairing a session. It was a seminar organized by the LSR, Lady Sri Ram College, on women and leadership. And there was, sitting next to me was the national secretary of the BJP. And all the young women in the hall asked her a tough question on 377. What is your party stand on 377? As if this is the right and you all are wrong. This would not have been a question you could ask 10 years ago. So I think we have to look at history and you'll begin to see, but the counter discourse has to be mounted. If we don't mount it and all the young generation and a whole generation of young people buy into the main discourse, the hegemonic discourse, then you all have lost a generation. And I don't know what the consequences are for the planet, for the biosphere. Which brings me to the next very difficult question. Who's counter discourse? Why should we buy into that? And you illustrated that by talking about the farmer who wants a Western education. That's absolutely right. I mean, in fact, we are having this very complex situation in the country today in school education. If you read all the educationists, they say education in the mother tongue. Rabindranath Tagore gives a classic illustration of Ireland, which was able to salvage Western culture against the predations of the barbarians. And then the Anglo-Saxons came and wiped out Irish education and made them study English. And he uses the language, the studying of English produced crippled minds. Okay? And therefore he's saying that language should be in the native language, education should be in the native language. Because the native language is organic, and there's a lot of value to that argument. It enables you, you have 16 words for rain, you have 12 words for whatever, for the seasons, 7 words for the types of fish which are fresh and not so fresh. In Goa, we have many ways to describing freshness of fish. We don't just say it's fresh or it's not fresh, you know, it's... But the subalterns want English. They want, because they have no problem with Konkani or Marathi or Hindi or Kannada. They want English because English is the language of commerce. So I don't have an answer to your question. I know it's a complex one. I know educational values are better in the mother tongue, but access is better, commercial success is better in this foreign tongue. So I don't know. I mean, I talk to taxi drivers who may be very conservative in their practices, but they want their daughters to learn in English because they can read Urdu. That we learn in the madrasa. But I'm saying this real because this is my sort of pop ethnography, you know. Always talk to taxi drivers because they give you a lot of what's happening in. So therefore, who's alternative? Now I can answer that question from a community-centric thing but from a big picture frame. There has to be an alternative from the viewpoint of sustainability, not from the viewpoint of A, B, or C community, because then I'm caught in the paradox that you very rightly specified. They want English, but we tell them you don't get English. They want modern medicine, you say no, do Ayurveda. But from a big picture perspective, because, and not just for them, for all of us, that we need a counter discourse, because business as usual is not an option available to us. That's my point. It's not an option available to us, and this is said by 5,000 scientists who are part of IPCC. So it's not, I mean, it's, you know, I'm relying on hard science, hard Western science, that we cannot sustain this any longer. We are going to face a huge water crisis. There's going to be food riots, and the oceans are slowing down. The ocean currents are slowing down, which means the whole global weather patterns are going to change. So I don't think we have that option. So whose alternative? I think if we, let's put it this way, I think that's a question I can postpone answering. Yeah. I can only postpone answering it because I know that between now and the time of answering it, if I support enough alternative discourses, and the counter discourse made up of alternative discourses is rich and varied enough, I will be in a position to answer that question. Because then I will have engaged with the Bolivian worldview, with the South African worldview, with the Indonesian worldview, with the worldview of the archipelagic nations. You know, and there are all these very complex worldviews of how to deal with the tsunami, how to deal with, and we need all of that for the sustainability of the planet. The sustainability of planet's perspective cannot come from Woods Hole Oceanographic Institute in the US. That's what I'm trying to say. Because your conception of nature has to change. Your conceptual relationship of nature has to change. You have to see animals and plants differently, as not just objects for, you know, the power of human, of the human person. We have to move from an anthropocentric cosmology.
I agree with your sentiment, and I agree with the fact that, you know, values should change. But I want to just pose a question, and from the point of view, let's say, an economic interpretation of how the world changes. So basically, you see, there is a reason why capitalism is dominating and winning the battles. And you go back 200 years, it has been able to wipe out feudalism. And in our present context, we see that we have to really try to understand why socialism, with a totally different value system, could not succeed. And why, after the crisis of the 1980s, generally, the oil crisis and stagflation and so forth, once again, globalization, it's re-emerged as globalization. And in the process of re-emergence, it's wiped out
everywhere.
All the so many different kinds of nationalistic ideologies and value systems across the world. So that's something really to be understood. And I think ultimately at the root of it is the fact that materialist aspirations somehow are there at the core of the matter. And by offering some kind of materialistic resolution to individuals, you are able to break down social cohesion. And that is the crux of the success everywhere, because you allow a middle class person to suddenly offer a middle class person who's yesterday unsure of getting a job. In my time in Calcutta, when we were getting educated, we were not at all sure that we'll have a job. And now you move a situation, you can and graduate and get a 50 lakhs or it, etc. So you see what's happening is that somehow the incentive system is been able to win a competitive battle. So therefore, if you want to talk about any of the other ideologies and the new visions and values, et cetera, that are coming, a method must be found where you're able to, in some quote-unquote, out-compete capitalism. And if you look at this particular present, the globalization issue, under globalization, things succeeded because it was able to come up with a solution to the global crisis that was obviously latent everywhere. We can see coming ahead, very likely, the next big crisis is actually going to be the environmental crisis. And so therefore, the way out of this mess seems to me to be able to come with a coherent system of organization, production, distribution, survival, the material part of it, which is in some sense able to outcompete the alternative model. Because you see, in everywhere you'll find that they will try to plunge in before the show. I mean, there are a lot of capitalist countries, firms that are trying to get into the solar all over the place. Everywhere there is an opportunity which is reflecting some social reality, it is being moved in a particular way. But if you don't want the capitalist, either you say that capitalism itself can be reformed under a different kind of value system, and that will solve our problem, or you have to say that a different kind of cooperative linkage, cooperative mode of organization is likely to be able to be superior to the standard, high scale material success of the thing. So I mean, I'm looking at it from the point of economic survival, you see, economic competition.
To begin by saying that that there was a disjunction between the beliefs and practice of Western universities, and therefore this might be one of the cues to go back and look at something else, you know, in our own traditions. So if you look at the Indian tradition, there was a similar disjunction between Vedanta and, you know, extreme forms of caste exploitation. That's one comment. The other, you know, thing that I want to ask is partly related to Chiranjeev's, you know, question that capitalism has been able to destroy a number of competitors. Now, if you look at, you know, one of the reasons, you know, why these things have been destroyed is that human mobility has increased a lot. So, if you look at, you know, socialism, they collapsed simultaneously with the collapse of migration barriers. So, do you think that, you know, one of the ways of, you know, countering both, you know, capitalism and you know, climate change would be to build local societies where, you know, where you artificially impose constraints on traveling. So, I mean, to give you a brief example, in America, there are a number of, you know, communities which are throwbacks in the medieval time, and they impose constraints on, you know, doing things. You cannot travel, you cannot educate. Yeah, exactly. So do you think that this would be the only, I personally feel that these kind of constrained local societies would be the only way out of global hegemony of, you know, capitalism and Western intellectual traditions.
To continue in a similar vein, at a system level, capitalism is persistent, it is resilient, it's highly productive, it must be getting something right. And when we were students, we learned, in one of the things we learned was that from Marx, the seeds of future social formations were contained in existing formations. So it may not be in the contradictions, but in what it's getting right, that we might look for alternative imaginations. Now, I think one of the things I wanted to comment on, not just your presentation, but otherwise also, is that these alternative imaginations are often rooted in certain kinds of primitivist simplifications. I would expect that a society which replaces a capitalist mode of production would be more complex. It would have a far greater degree of coherence. It would be diversified. It would not be a simpler primitive or a somewhat technologically less sophisticated society. In some ways, I feel this view of the alternative imagination is reflected in the current legitimacy that sustainability notion has acquired in the last 10 years. You know, unlike development, sustainability has not been critiqued politically. So an inability understand that a future society has to be more complex, perhaps even more stratified. It may be stratified in different ways, is matched by a naturalizing of a political crisis, which is what sustainability really is. So this whole mantra of sustainability and this alternative imagination, they seem to be complementing each other. I would suggest that we start thinking about more complex answers to the challenges that capitalism faces, rather than drawing from historically romantic traditions.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the really clearly formulated questions. And let me see if I can, these are questions that I have also been struggling with, so I would not like you to see this as a kind of counter to what you've said. I mean, I'd like it, like to see it as a conversation, I agree that capitalism has won because it's outcompeted all its challenges. It's done it because it has, in a sense, produced a certain material culture, which has satisfied its supporters and its adherents. So how is one going to challenge this? And the environmental crisis is the one that's going to confront capitalism much more. In terms of a macro answer, I don't have an answer, because I don't think anybody has. I mean, I do know that there are very interesting experiments taking place within the capitalist world itself. And these are responses to, one response to the capitalist strategy is the increasing growth of philanthropo-capitalism. And that's one response to, and that's actually fairly similar to trusteeship. Because the idea is you should only keep one, there's a 1% pledge, and the rest goes into philanthropy. Is this trying to humanize capitalism? You could say yes, you could say no, but will it affect the structure of production and reproduction? I don't know. But my optimism comes from the belief that if we invest the same technical tools and arguments that economists do in arguing within the capitalist framework, I suspect counters would emerge. And I offer trusteeship as an argument, because trusteeship is to me similar to reward, trusteeship is similar to merit, trust, you know, all these are very normative concepts that are at the core of the manner in which the benefits are being distributed. You've earned it, you've qualified for it, and while there is a hard empirical dimension to it, there's a soft normative dimension to each of these actions. And when they get quantified and measured, by a pool of skilled technicians who say, yeah, this is fine, this is fair, this is just, this is whatever. I'm saying if we start doing the same, if we use our collective knowledge products to do that for the alternate things, they would not be seen as romantic and backward. They are not backward-looking. I want to suggest them as forward-looking, and I'll tell you why I think that. So can it outcompete? Can there be other forms of social organization which can compete with this? I think we can begin to find them. I think if you look at the Scandinavian countries, some examples are emerging. For example, off the coast of Copenhagen, the same infrastructure development has taken place, but they've created a form where the condominiums, for example, that they've developed, which is the most high-priced, have to be made available to even subaltern groups, not only those who can pay. You've actually created a public culture where you must create a plural community. In America, the only model is gated communities. If you can afford it, you're in. If you can't afford it, you go and already live in the... So, you know, counters are available within capitalism and outside capitalism, and we have to find them. So all I'm saying is, let's do this collective enterprise. Why? Because I think capitalism has certainly brought us on the threshold of, you know, wealth that we've never seen before. But if we could continue indefinitely like this, then I have no problem. But my IPCC is telling me we cannot continue. So something has to give way, and has to give way at the fundamental level. If there was no IPCC, then Gandhi becomes a romantic. But since there is IPCC, Gandhi's a realist. When 5,000 scientists are saying all these are the consequences of the way you've been living, I mean, and when, for example, coming back to the number of bees is declining because of the use of pesticide. Number of bees declining means fruit and food production is going to, because pollination. So now you're actually getting people going around with, you know, sets of, I mean, apiaries, going around offering services of bees, which are naturally producing, because today there is a huge crisis of horticulture, because we've killed the natural process of cross-pollination, and through capitalist production, I mean, through the use of pesticide, through your, so if food, I mean, take the ocean currents. The ocean currents are necessary for keeping the fish stock alive, and if you have a cold Arctic cap, then the contrast in temperatures moves the Gulf Stream. The Gulf Stream is slowing down. The slowing down of the Gulf Stream means the churning of the oceans is affected. Churning of the oceans affected means the fish are not getting enough nutrients. You know, the plankton and all. So this is science. So business as usual is not an option. That's what I'm saying. And therefore we have to look at the count. History has shown us that capitalism has outcompeted everybody. But at the heart of capitalism is a very normative argument. I mean, people, Adam Smith's theory of moral sentiments is actually the text that precedes the Wealth of Nations. And that's unfortunately that is ignored, and Wealth of Nations is seen as the Bible text. And Amartya Sen has got a long preface to the theory of moral sentiments. I think let's go to that. Let's begin to look at the moral dimensions, which is not romantic, because at the heart of all so-called positive science is a moral dimension, only unacknowledged. And through logical argumentation, you can unearth it. I mean, at the idea of every positive science is a conception of the good. It requires logical regress to unearth it, you know, through interrogation. And I'm saying, therefore, let's start this exercise, because IPCC says we don't have the option. I mean, we are on 1 minute to midnight, you know, in the climate clock. But you're absolutely right, we have to create the technical knowledge to be able to counter it. And that will only come when enough people begin to believe that we have to. I mean, if capitalism was able to outcompete feudalism, it did it not only because it was more productive, but because it created a new structure of law. It created the contract. And through that, it said, no, this is not, rights are not hereditary, rights have to be based on contract. Why can't we create such instruments? You know, I mean, the body of ideas that underlie capitalism is not cast in stone. They were made. Many of them are conventions. Now they have a naturalized status. I'm saying let's create a new naturalized status. And I'm giving you an example. This is not just wish fulfillment. I'm saying take trusteeship. Take big concepts like this and let us subject it to the same kind of rigor. And what is proportion? How much is proportion? How much is fair proportion? When Gandhi says a part belongs to you and part belongs to God, should it be 1:7? Somebody responded to Gandhi and said, no, make it 1:10. He says, no, I'm not. In the deserts of Rajasthan, the proportion may be 1:5. But in a productive equatorial region like Goa, it may be 1:25, you know? So what constitutes a fair proportion has to be, which then brings me to the mobility question I don't have an answer. You know, I mean, I really don't want to be seduced into giving you an answer, because I think that must come from communities who already you find communities, for example, driving long distances to buy organic produce. You know, they won't go to the nearest supermarket. So people are making these lifestyle choices of how to change our lives so that we can sustain. But that is coming from public cultures like Germany, Sweden, etc. It's not, maybe in the United States, but you know, the United States is driven by the media to consume, you know, I mean, it's not, other places are beginning to fight this. As I gave you the example of Denmark, where they've created public housing in the most expensive. So single parent households below the, you know, on welfare get through lottery, get, exclusive condominiums. So we have to create this counter thing. But there's always this pessimistic answer, that maybe the Fred Hoyle answer, which is that, you know, maybe life on Earth was an accident, you know, and And in a billion years, we'll die. There'll be some other planet in which there is life. You've seen this, the black cloud. Fred Hoyle, the astronomer, was asked about how did life originate on Earth. And he just delinked it from any mystical. He said life on Earth was an accident. There was a cloud with all the juices in it, cosmic cloud. It banged against the Earth, and that first organic molecule emerged, from which life emerged. But that cloud has been sprouting life all over the universe. And if we kill ourselves in a nuclear holocaust, okay, one experiment didn't work. I mean, that's a pessimistic thing, but I'm optimistic. I think I go with Freeman Dyson, who thinks that there is a purpose. I mean, so we've dealt with such crisis, and I believe that is why the opportunity to speak to young people in different institutions becomes so important. Because I think the answers will come from creativity and innovation, as has always been the case in history that human beings experience. And then finally, I've answered the primitivist position, because I don't think it's primitivist. It may seem primitivist but as again, Oscar Wilde, I love Oscar Wilde's statement on utopia. He says, utopia is a place that you're always aspiring to reach, and when you reach, then you set off journey again to find another place. I think without utopias, we cannot do any social theorizing. So I'm for utopias, but I'm for engaging with them in a critical way, so that we engage with the idea by mustering evidence and by mustering argument. I could not agree more with you that we have to do this, because the future has to be more complex. The future is more complex. So the futures we aspire for has to contain that complexity, even though it may be simple in form. I mean, I'm not in any way diminishing the argument of complexity, but I think it need not be socially organized in the ways in which we are doing through a kind of muddling through process. And I think, if I'm right, again, I've only got a glimpse of this, I think the technical sciences are beginning to deal with these kind of complex models. Now, is sustainability the new developmentalism? It's actually more political than scientific. I would like, I mean, if I go by much of the anecdotal evidence that a non-scientist like me has access to, and I give you the example of the bees and the example of the rhododendrons, you could treat these as unique events. You can treat them as, when you look at the snow peaks from Shimla, and everyone in Shimla tells you, but this year, sir, the ice is very bad. It's never been so bad. In the month of March, normally the ice is much more than the snow peaks. From the distance, you're looking at it, from the distance, the range. Then they are saying that something has changed, and this is locals, people who always done their namaskar every morning to the snow peaks. So I think climate change is serious. I'm not a skeptic on that. And if you work backwards in the argument, you come to sustainability, which means you come to lifestyle practices that would not cause such severe consequences to the ecosystem in which we are located. And these consequences are severe. There is a depletion of fish stock, there is a depletion of groundwater, there is a huge, there is a dying of rivers, and so on and so on. We can get into the argument on facts. So I think sustainability is a fact. It's not a, it's now acquired a political momentum. But that is to change attitudes, to create policies, to create the policies which would enable sustainability. We have to create a counter discourse. Others, I feel sorry for the next generation, because we've had our fun. They have to live in the planet that we are going to bequeath to them. So thank you. Any more?